Allah is my heart's speech. Your mercy is what I beseech. Keep in my heart your remembrance, and in your deen allow me to advance. Help me in my quest. Permit me to pass the ultimate test. Help me in my quest. Permit me to pass the ultimate test.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Praise be to Allah alone. We all praise Him and we seek His help. Whomsoever Allah guides is a truly guided one. And whomsoever Allah leaves astray, no one can show him guidance. May the peace and blessings be upon Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Dear viewers everywhere, welcome to a new edition of your program, Ask Huda. Our contact information is beginning with the phone numbers, area code 002-0238-555 248-249, and the email address is ask@huda.tv. Our Facebook page is www.facebook.com/msalahofficial. I've just got a couple of pending questions. Meanwhile, you can start ringing in as soon as you have a chance, inshallah. Azza Jal. In the beginning, I'd like to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bestow His mercy on us and to teach us what we don't know and to help us to act upon what we learn of His right deen. Ameen. Abdullah from Sweden, who called earlier last episode, and he said he got a job in the marketing department of the post office in Sweden. And he said, as you know, that in the post office we deliver different types of packages, including alcohol or even porno materials. Is this type of work permissible? In the previous episode, I answered specifically pertaining a person who carries alcohol or anything that is prohibited, and he knows the package contains whatever, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, لَعَنَ اللَّهُ الْخَمْرَ وَحَامِلَهَا وَشَارِبَهَا وَبَائِعَهَا وَسَاقِيهَا. When the Prophet ﷺ said that Allah has cursed 10 people pertaining wine, 9 plus wine itself, alcohol or any intoxicants or anything that is similar to intoxicants by analogy. Also, the Prophet ﷺ said in the hadith, إِنَّ اللَّهَ إِذَا حَرَّمَ شَيْئًا حَرَّمَ ثَمَنَهُ. Whenever Allah prohibits anything, then He prohibits its price. He prohibits selling the item. He prohibits carrying the item, being an intermediary or dealing with it in the stock market, even without having to touch it. Similarly, by consulting my superior, my shuyukh, we spoke a lot today about the issue of the person in the job development in a department where he does not handle personally these packages, but he's involved. And as I said repeatedly, we came to the conclusion that the ayah of Surah Al-Ma'idah, in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَتَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْبِرِّ وَالتَّقْوَى وَلَا تَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْإِثْمِ وَالْعُدْوَانِ, is a milestone and is a reference in answering all similar questions. You're not supposed to help any person who's committing a sin or transgression. And you are ordered to assist and help those who are doing what's righteous and what's good. وَتَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْبِرِّ وَالتَّقْوَى. Help one another, assist one another to achieve righteousness and piety. But do not help one another in committing sins or transgression. وَلَا تَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْإِثْمِ وَالْعُدْوَانِ. It becomes only permissible to accept such job whenever you fail to find any job and it is a necessity. In some countries, such as in the States, we all know that if you don't work, you will be kicked out of your house and you will live in the streets. And if you don't work, you don't have health insurance, you don't have coverage. I mean, it's a series of disasters. There is a difference if you're living in a country where even if you don't work, like in Europe, in the UK, for instance, that you're still covered, you can survive. Then the necessity means that if you do not take this job, there is no other alternative. You will be in the street, your kids will get lost, you will starve. Then you will take it with a limit in order to suffice for your basic needs. And meanwhile, you are still looking for a halal job. Remember, this entire life is all about tests and trials. And Allah is testing us with our wealth as well as with our children. نَمَا أَمْوَالُكُمْ وَأَوْلَادُكُمْ فِتْنَةً وَاللَّهُ عِنْدَهُ أَجْرٌ عَظِيمٌ. And I would like also to share with you something very interesting, which is Whenever a strong Muslim is tested with something like that, for instance, a job with a very big salary, but he knows that there is something haram in it, or it is entirely haram, so he abstains, then rejoice. Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in the hadith, مَنْ تَرَكَ شَيْئًا لِلَّهِ أَبْدَلَهُ اللَّهُ خَيْرًا مِنْ. Whoever gives up on anything for the sake of Allah, because that thing is prohibited, that thing displeases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then rejoice, because Allah will replace it to you with something much better. That is Allah's promise. Barakallahu fikum. I believe you also had a similar question from Sister Moon from the United Arab Emirates pertaining selling books, textbooks with images of women jogging in a pair of shorts or swimming or whatever. So also, the answer, which I answered to the earlier question, applies here. Do not assist in doing anything which is known that it is a sin. Some people say, I don't look at it myself, I don't eat it, I don't smoke, I don't carry the lotto tickets, I do not get involved in the sin myself, I only sell it to those who consider it lawful. I say, no. وَلَا تَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْإِثْمِ وَالْعُدْوَانِ. I'm sorry to say I say, because I'm just a transmitter. I'm transmitting, and I'm reminding myself and my dear viewers with the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Barakallahu feekum. Brother Ali from the USA, he called last episode and he said, before I reverted to Islam, I stole a significant amount of money from my neighbor. He said, 2 years later, I accepted Islam, and this is indeed the great blessing that Allah has blessed with, to accept Islam and to be rightly guided. And I have now spent the last 5 years begging him to forgive me and forget my debt. He told my sister that he forgave me, but every time I contact him, he insults me and curses me. Can I consider his debt forgiven? SubhanAllah, brothers and sisters, I want you to pay attention to this. Before Islam, it wasn't a big deal. Somebody steals from somebody because he's got a lot of money. So what? The consciousness and to be aware of the fact that this is called stealing, and Allah is fully aware of what you did, and there will be a day for recompense, and you will be held accountable, and you will be punished for that. It's a package that you only find in Islam. As the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in the hadith of Mu'ad ibn Jabal, may Allah be pleased with him, اتَّقِ اللَّهَ حَيْثُ مَا كُنْتُ. Fear Allah and keep your duty to him wheresoever you are. You are in a Muslim or a non-Muslim land, in an open public place or in the hidden, whether there is a blackout and no surveillance cameras, or you're being seen by others, you are watching Allah because He's watching you. You're not watching people. So the brother has this urge of settling his debt, of making sure that the person has forgiven him before a day in which this person would ask for his rights. But this person is a non-Muslim, so what? Transgression is prohibited, whether you transgress against Muslims or non-Muslims. Honesty, truthfulness, justice are the main teachings of Islam and the manners of Islam which Muslims should adapt, whether while dealing with Muslims or non-Muslims. And the Quran is full of ayat in this regard, such as the ayat of Surah Al-Ma'idah. وَلَا يَجْرِمَنَّكُمْ شَنَآنُ قَوْمٍ عَلَىٰ أَنْ لَا تَعْدِلُوا اِعْدِلُوا هُوَ أَقْرَبُ لِلتَّقْوَى. For instance, even if those people are your enemies, you have to be just, you have to be honest in dealing with them. So I'd like to tell you that whenever a person repents from a theft, then it is required to render back the amount or the property which he stole from the person, if it is still available, or if it is wasted, then its value, in order to settle the case with the person whom you wrong. Unless if the person himself pardons you and tells you straightforward in your face, I have forgiven you. If he says that once, that's it. The case is settled. Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said in one hadith, you better settle such cases before a day will come on which there will not be any dirham nor dinar. Yani, there will not be any wealth, monetary. You cannot settle your case by giving any money. A person who possesses as you know, this is hypothetically, if a person possesses the whole world, gold and silver, all the mountains, all the dirt has turned into gold in his hand, and he wants to settle his cases with gold, no one would accept it from him. Where there will not be any dirham nor dinar. Rather, the dealing will be based on good deeds and bad deeds. So if a person has wronged somebody, particularly pertaining properties, whether it's a private property or a public property, you know that on the battlefield, somebody died. So the companions assumed that he's a shaheed. The Prophet ﷺ said, "Huwa fi an-nar." He'll be doomed to the fire fell. Why? فِي شَمْلَةٍ غَلَّهَا. Because he stole from the war spoils, which is a property that belongs to the entire ummah, shamla, a scarf or a shawl. He stole it. So we have to be very careful with others' properties, whether it's personal, private property, or a public property. If the person said to you once, "I forgive you," fine. If he's hesitant, then you have to work hard in settling this case with him by giving him either the property itself or its current value. Barakallahu feek, Ali, and thank you for being keen to settle this case before it's too late. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Sister Hamna from the KSA.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, Sheikh.
How are you, Sister Hamna?
Alhamdulillah, fine.
Naam.
Sheikh, I have a question.
Naam.
Inshallah, we will be going abroad the next month to France, inshallah.
Inshallah.
So I have a question that in the boats, if halal is written, but people tell that it is not halal, so can we eat from there?
What is halal? What's written halal?
Halal, the food.
The food? You mean the meat?
Yes.
Okay, which country are you going to?
France, inshallah.
France. So it says halal, it's marked as halal. There are some restaurants which they have that certificate halal. That indicates is halal because there is a committee that inspects the stores. Last time I was in the UK, I saw many stores, even non-Muslim stores, which have a sign that says serves halal. So I inquired about it and it said, because there are inspectors, they can inspect the stores, the restaurants, grocery stores, at any time. They have to make sure that they collected the meat from a halal meat, slaughterhouses, and it is processed in a halal fashion. That should be sufficient. You're not required to investigate by tracing the food all the way to the source, because if there is a committee, trustworthy committee, inspectors who inspect the certificates and those who bear the certificates, that should be sufficient, inshallah. Unless, if it is very well known that this is just a scam and it is not really effective, then in this case we'll avoid it. But since alhamdulillah wa shukrillah, it is known that Muslims who are supervising this and Muslim inspectors, every once in a while they check on these stores, then it should be sufficient. You don't have to do any extra homework. Barakallahu feekum.
Yeah, I also wanted to ask that even in Saudi Arabia, there are a few like restaurants, a few shops which say halal, but the people say, we get mails, we get emails, that no, this is not halal, the meat is not good, and things like that.
As I said in the beginning, because you will always find people who object to everything and anything, even to fish, to vegetables, but it is sufficient to know that there is a committee or there are inspectors who inspect the food suppliers to the restaurants and the restaurants themselves. Especially when you know, alhamdulillah, we've seen all over Europe and North America, Muslim owners who own restaurants and they run them. So that should be sufficient. I don't have to ask him again. I saw the sign, it says halal. I don't have to ask the store owner or the cook whether the food is halal or not, because the word halal or the sign halal is sufficient, inshallah. You're not blameworthy in case that it was not. Thank you, Sister Hamna. Ummu Fatima, assalamu alaikum, and welcome to Ask Huda.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, Sheikh. Sheikh, I have one question, and this is on behalf of my friend. She has delivered recently, and she has named her baby girl Alicia Rida. and I brought to her notice that Rida is actually a male gender name. I'm not much aware of it because I'm not from Arabic origin, but could you actually tell me what Alicia means and what Rida is, or should it be Rida or Ridan for a female?
So you said Aisha or Alicia?
Alicia.
Alicia?
She said Alicia is an Indian origin name, and it means, according to the Indian origin, the one who is protected by Allah.
Alicia is the one who is protected by Allah. Okay, thank you for informing us. Okay, the word Rida in Arabic means to be pleasant with something, to be pleased with something, to be happy with. Rida also means satisfaction, to be content. And it goes for both masculine or feminine. In the Indo-Pak community, they have this tradition of having compound or even sometimes complex names, more than one name, the same person. So both names, because now you informed us about the meaning of the word Alicia, okay? The person who's protected by Allah, according to your explanation, that is okay, and Rida too is okay. Yet, for me myself, I like to name my daughter Ruqayya, Aisha, Fatima, Zainab, Khadija, many, many beautiful names of the lady companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. In order also to fit what Ibn al-Qayyim, may Allah have mercy on him, said in one of his statements, Al-Asma'u Aw'iyatun Limusammayatiha. The word Wa'a is a vessel. And Al-Asma' are like vessels for what they contain. Whenever you name a child, a name that is after one of the companions, after one of the prophets, it does have an effect on the child throughout their entire life until they grow up. They adopt some of the traits, if not most of the traits, of the person whom you named him after. Barakallahu fiki, Ummu Fatima. Brother Ali from the USA also asked about wiping over my shoes when making ablution. He discussed that he made wudu, then he put his socks on, then he put his shoes on. Okay? We said if it is something that covers the ankles, like the boots, then you may wipe over it. And if you take them off, excuse me, and now you want to make a new wudu, then you have to take them off and wash your feet. You have to wash the feet. But if the person puts the socks on, then put the shoes on, he may wipe over the shoes if they cover the ankles, or over the socks, likewise, if they cover the ankles. Because nowadays, there are low-cut socks beneath the ankles. Such socks, even if they're very thick, it's not sufficient to provide the condition or the term which will make the socks fit to wipe over them. For the resident, as Ali ibn Abi Talib, may Allah be pleased with him, narrated that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam prescribed wiping over the socks for a resident a day and night, 24 hours, from the moment you start wiping, not the moment you put them on. And for a traveler, 72 hours, yani 3 days and 3 nights, again from the moment you start wiping over your socks or boots. How does this happen? Let me give you an example. If I made wudu, then I put my shoes on, my boot on, or my socks, I put them on. Then I stayed for 3 prayers without any need to make wudu. Now I answer the call of nature. If I put the socks on and I made wudu, al-dhuhr. At Isha, I needed to renew my wudu. So I wipe over my socks. There is no need to take them off. And the time begins from the moment I start wiping, not from the moment I put them on. 24 hours, a day and night. And for the traveler, 3 days and 3 nights. Barakallahu feekum. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Sister Nadia from the KSA.
Hello.
Assalamu alaikum.
Sheikh, I have one question.
Please.
My daughter, the youngest one, she is like 2 years and 9 months, and her name is So when I kept her name and she was born, it was in my mind that I would keep one of...
Sister Nadia, I'm sorry, your voice broke off and we couldn't hear the name. Her name is what?
Her name is Maria.
Maria.
Yeah. So when she was born, she was about to born, it was in my mind to give her name one of Prophet's wife's name. So Khadija and Aisha was already in my family, so I was thinking about Zainab and Maria, and I kept her name Maria. And it's, I don't know its meanings, but I know that this is Prophet's wife's name. So, but last week, she gets on and off very sick. Somebody in a month, 2-3 times she gets sick. Yeah. Many times she has different problems. So one of my friends last week, she told me that you better to change her name. But I just wanted to ask you, because I already kept her name in this thinking that it is Prophet's wife's name. So is it true that we have to change the name if the person is sick or become sick very often? Is it true that we can change the name because of this reason?
Okay. So, Barakallahu feek, Sister Nadia. Thank you so much. We do not believe in bad omens. Okay? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, La adwa wa la tiyara. A tiyara is a practice that you used to do in Jahiliyyah before Islam. If a person were to decide pertaining a serious matter, to travel or not, to marry or not, to do a business or not, would fly a bird. And the bird is at-ta'ir. So if the bird, yatir, to fly to the right, that's an indication, yeah, go for it. And if the bird flew to the left, then he's pessimistic, which means, no, this is a bad omen. It will be very awful. So the Prophet ﷺ said, we do not believe in bad omens. In the West and in the non-Muslim community, whether here or there, they are very pessimistic pertaining certain names, numbers, days, all of that is haram in Islam. Why? Because that would not change anything of the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I mentioned before that number 13, for instance, in America is like a very serious danger. Lofty buildings, you take the elevator, 10, 11, 12, 14. What happened to 13? Does not exist. Okay? Similarly, the names would be only due to change if the name is carrying a bad meaning or an indication of sitting partners to Allah in worship, such as a name of a shirk, Abdul Uzza, Abdul Lat, Abdul Shams. These names must be changed. Okay? Or a name indicating a sin, Asiyah. One lady, her name was Asiyah, and the Prophet ﷺ changed her name to Jamila, beautiful or pretty. Okay, so if the name, but Maria is basically the name of Ummu Walad Nabiya sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Maria al Qibtiyah is a woman whom Al Muqawqis, the Egyptian ruler, gave her as a gift along with a ride or so to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam as a gift. And she carried his child and he died afterward. So it is a good name. And originally the name is Maryam. Maryam. And if you'd like to name your daughter Maryam, that would be much better than Maria. The other name is Maria, not Maria. Maria is the English meaning of Maryam, who is the mother of Isa alayhi salam. وَمَرْيَمَ بَنَتَ عِمْرَانَ الَّتِي أَحْصَنَتْ فَرْجَهَا. Allah praised Maryam, peace be upon her. And she was blessed in the Quran due to the invocation of her mother. إِذْ قَالَتْ in Surah Ali Imran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ اصْطَفَى آدَمَ وَنُوحًا وَآلَ إِبْرَاهِيمَ وَآلَ عِمْرَانَ عَلَى الْعَالَمِينَ ذُرِّيَّةً بَعْضُهَا مِنْ بَعْضٍ وَاللَّهُ سَمِيعٌ عَلِيمٌ إِذْ قَالَتِ امْرَأَةُ عِمْرَانَ رَبِّ إِنِّي نَذَرْتُ لَكَ مَا فِي بَطْنِي مُحَرَّرًا فَتَقَبَّلْ مِنِّي إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ السَّمِيعُ الْعَلِيمُ. فلما وضعتها قالت رب إني وضعتها أنثى والله أعلم بما وضعت وليس الذكر كالأنثى وإني سميتها مريم وإني أعيذها بك وذريتها من الشيطان الرجيم فتقبلها ربها بقبول حسن وأنبتها نباتا حسنا وكفلها زكريا. The آيات of سورة آل عمران. So Maryam is a blessed name and she's the daughter of Imran and his wife, and they both made her as a nazr to be a devout worshipper to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah chose her to carry and to bear Isa alayhi salam without having to be with a man, and the birth of Isa was a miraculous birth, as you all know. So this is the name Maryam. If you want to name her Maryam, that's perfectly fine and it's easy to change it to Maryam. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Yusuf from Nigeria.
Wa alaykum as-salam wa rahmatullah. How are you, Sheikh?
Alhamdulillah. Thank you for asking, Brother Yusuf. How are you yourself?
Alhamdulillah, Sheikh. For the other time on Sunday, I asked a question concerning the sitting that you do after before standing up in Salat. After the two sujood, you sit down first before you stand up. But unfortunately, in Nigeria, I think there was TV went off. I could not hear your response. To the extent, one of the malams here, local imam, said that even the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did that when he was actually old and weak. So somebody is not supposed to do that if you are healthy. So while others are saying, no, it is the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, whether is where you are healthy or not, you should do it. So that brought a confusion that some people even refused to follow the imam that was doing that, that because they say he's healthy, so he's not supposed to do it, that the only condition is if you are not healthy, that that is the only time that you are supposed to sit before standing up.
Now, okay. Right. Inshallah, I will answer you. After the short break, inshallah, I'll get back to you, answer Yusuf's question and the remaining pending questions. Please stay tuned.
Are you looking for a way to recharge your hearts? Or to get you back on track in your obedience to Allah? Or maybe you're looking for a program to remind you of your duties to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Here on Living Hearts, we'll be working together as a nation, helping each other to remain firm in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Every Saturday, live on Huda TV, you will have a chance to learn your deen and at the same time, listen to real life stories that will make your heart shake. Every believer needs a place to turn. And inshallah, we can all turn to Living Hearts.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome back. Right before the break, Brother Yusuf from Nigeria inquired about what's known as jilsatul istiraha. Jilsatul istiraha. You know, in Arabic, the word jilsa has a meaning versus jalsa. Jalsa is whenever we have a meeting and we're all sitting down. From julus, sitting down. But jilsa is the way you sit. How do you sit? Crossing legs. You sit in whichever way you sit, that description is called jilsa. So there is a liftirash, there is a tawarruk, as we explained before in the prayer. Jilsatul istiraha is when you sit after the witr prayer, yani between the two sajdas. This is how Malik ibn al-Huwayrith, may Allah be pleased with him, narrated that he saw the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was sitting between each two sajdas. And before going to the second rak'ah, because the first rak'ah is a witr prayer. Then after the second rak'ah, anyway, you sit for the middle tashahud. Then if you're going to the third rak'ah, you get up after the tashahud, and when you sit down for the sujood of the third rak'ah, this is a witr rak'ah or an odd rak'ah. So before going to the fourth rak'ah, you pause. Again, in a very simple way, I'm trying to explain this hadith, which is collected by Imam al-Bukhari, and he used this hadith, it's a sound hadith, as a reference. Similarly, Imam al-Shafi'i or Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, in one of the views, consider the hadith of Imam al-Bukhari, which is narrated by Malik ibn al-Huwairith, as a reference in this regard, which means it is mustahab, it is recommended for every musalli to sit down, to pause before going to the second rak'ah and the fourth rak'ah. Yani after the first rak'ah, which is an odd rak'ah, and after the third rak'ah, which is again is an odd rak'ah. This sitting is mustahab. Why? Because Malik ibn al-Huwairith said, I have seen the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam doing so. Al-Imam Abu Hanifa, may Allah have mercy on him, and Al-Imam Malik are of the view that it is not a sunnah. And they said that the Prophet ﷺ was doing that due to an old age. When he got old, he used to break, he used to rest before rising for the second rak'ah and before rising for the fourth rak'ah. Okay. Al-Imam al-Bukhari, Al-Imam al-Shafi'i, and one views of the Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal said, أَفْعَالُ النَّبِيَّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ السُنَن. We should follow all the actions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, unless if he says this is a special practice, such as when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was leading the prayer, and they used to pray in their boots. Then the Sahaba saw the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam took his boots off and he kicked them away. They used to pray on the sand, of course, on the dirt. So the Sahaba right away followed him, and they did likewise. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after finishing the prayer, said, why did he take your boots off? They said, because we have seen you doing so. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, no, I am only done so because Jibreel alayhi salam came to me and said that your shoes or boots have some najasa, impurities. Okay, so he explained that was a special practice. Fi hadithi dhil yadayn, many hadith were narrated pertaining the Prophet ﷺ has forgotten in the prayer once, and he made taslim after praying only two rak'ahs. He made taslim after praying three rak'ahs and without finishing the fourth rak'ah. In a dhuhr or a asr prayer, once he prayed and he went to the fifth rak'ah, the Prophet ﷺ said, because the Sahaba followed him and no one notified him. Why? They said, perhaps the prayer has been shortened. Perhaps there has been an addition to the prayer in the case where he prayed five rak'ahs. He said, إِنَّمَا أَنَا بَشَرٌ أَنْسَى كَمَا تَنْسَوْنَ. I'm just a human being. I forget like you do guys forget. So if I forget, remind me. فَإِذَا نَسِيتُ فَذَكِّرُونِ. By saying subhanAllah. So if there is an action or a practice which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did it for a reason, he notifies the companions, this is for a reason. Like, there is a common tradition in the Indian subcontinent. You see people, healthy people, after they pray Maghrib, they pray the Sunnah while sitting. Why? They think it is not permissible to pray the Nawafil while standing. On what reference do you rely in making such a hukm or verdict? Do you know that if you're capable to stand up in the prayer, in the Nafl, and then you choose to pray while sitting down, you only get half of the reward of the prayer. While in the case of the fard, if you pray while sitting, while able and capable to stand up, then the prayer is invalid. So we have to understand the difference in order to figure out what we're doing, whether it's right or wrong, sunnah or an innovation. So, according to the more right view, it is a sunnah, because the Prophet ﷺ said in the sound hadith, and this hadith, Shaykh al-Albani, may Allah have mercy on him, compiled a whole book, very beautiful message pertaining the description of the Prophet's prayer. And of course you have seen the program, the Prophet's prayer, based on that. He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, صَلُّوا كَمَا رَأَيْتُمُونِي أُصَلِّي. Pray as you have seen me praying. We have not seen him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, praying. But we have heard all the companions narrating, يعني the narrations which we have received from them in the sound collection, narrating how the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to pray. Uthman radiallahu anhu made a perfect wudu, then he prayed and he said, this is how the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made wudu, and this is how he prayed. Many companions narrated that he used to raise his hands in four positions in the salah. For takbiratul ihram, then for going for ruku', then for rising up from ruku', parallel to his earlobes, or parallel to his shoulders. Both are narrated that the Prophet ﷺ used to do these two hay'ah. And I call it hay'ah because when we read in the fiqh of worship pertaining to the salah, al-hay'at la tubtul salah. In case that somebody chose to follow the Hanafi madhab, where, okay, I'm not going to sit for the pause after the ad rak'ah and going to the evil rak'ah, it will not invalidate your prayer. According to Hanafi madhab, raising the hands only in the beginning takbir, which is known as takbiratul ihram, it's okay, you will miss the reward of raising the hands in the rest of the movements takbir, but it will not invalidate your prayer. According to the Hanafi madhab, this is where you place the right on the hand, on your stomach, and even beneath the navel. According to all the narrations that describe the Prophet ﷺ placing the right over the left, on top of his chest, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Yani, when it comes to the hay'ah, it will not affect the validity of the prayer, but it is better to follow the hadith, sallu kama ra'aytumuni usalli. Barakallahu fikum. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Abdul Rahim from Algeria. Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Please, you just answered the question now. About someone that stole public money and someone that stole private money, that the person should seek forgiveness from the private person. What about the public fund? If it is stolen, like the hadith you brought, that the war booty, those that stole are going to hellfire. So if that person now decides to seek repentance after he has committed the offense, stolen from public fund,
Abdul Rahim, assalamu alaikum. I do apologize, but wallahi, I didn't understand your question. I'm pretty sure, inshallah, the brothers in the control will bring your question to me in writing if you provide it to them. But there is a lot of echo in the sound. I couldn't really understand the question. I apologize. Barakallahu feek wa jazakallahu khairan. And inshallah, if they send me the question right now on my email address, I'll be able to answer it. Barakallahu feek. Naam. There was a question from Sister Asia from the KSA. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
How are you, sister?
Alhamdulillah, jazakallah khair. I just wanted to remind regarding my previous question to be answered, because I'm eagerly waiting for that. And I just want one more question to be answered. I told this. Actually, I need this for Thursday. There is a small gathering from my school where many other teachers will be coming along, and they have requested us to come. But they will be indulging in some music and song. But I and along with other sisters have planned of some Islamic quiz and speeches. We have plan of doing it on separate rooms, but they are insisting us to come, but we will separate ourselves from them. Do I'm supposed to go in such a gathering, or it is totally not allowed, though we have some good intention behind that?
No. When you have a chance to present the proper way, go. As long as you will not be involved in any violation, no problem. This is a party in a school. Some people would like to do it this way. There is a room for you to present the sunnah and to present proper quizzes and teach the audience there is a legitimate way, I would still go. Because there is a room for you to do what you think is right and avoid what's wrong. Also, your questions pertaining the ayat 28 and 29 of Surah Al-Insan. إِنَّ هَذِهِ تَذْكَرَةٌ فَمَنْ شَاءَ اتَّخَذَ إِلَىٰ رَبِّهِ سَبِيلًا. Whether it's a means of healing, I said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَنُنَزِّلُ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ مَا هُوَ شِفَاءٌ وَرَحْمَةٌ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ. The word min, we call it a letter in Arabic, it is not لِلْتَبْعِيد, which means a sum of. No, the whole Quran is a shifa. The whole Quran is a shifa. I don't have a specific reference. These two ayat are cure. But any part of the Quran, when you read it as a ruqya, is valid. And many times I mentioned that Amir al-Mu'mineen, Umar ibn al-Khattab, radiyallahu anhu, used to give ruqya only via reciting Surah al-Fatiha. And in the Sahih Hadith, which is collected by Imam al-Bukhari and narrated by Abu Sa'id al-Khudri, the man who gave ruqya to the non-Muslim who got bitten by a scorpion, and he recovered, فَكَأَنَّمَا نَشَطَ مِنْ عِقَالٍ. He was innocently cured due to the effect and the blessings of Surah Al-Fatiha, and they gave him a gift, 30 sheep. They took it to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They couldn't touch the sheep or its meat before they find out whether what he did was right or wrong. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, what did you recite on him? He said, I recited Surah Al-Fatiha. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam smiled to him and said, وَمَا يُدْرِيكَ أَنَّهَا رُقْيَةٌ. How did you know that it's a ruqya? He said, I just did it. So the smile of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the sunnah is considered approval. Any part of the Quran. Unless if there are certain indications pertaining certain ayat, ayatul kursi, there are a lot of ahadith pertaining its effect as far as protecting the person against the evil eye, the black magic, the jinn, the shayateen, etc. Surah Al-Baqarah at large, Ayat Al-Kursi is the greatest ayah of the Quran. And the last three chapters of the Quran, which are known as Al-Mu'awwidhat, plural of Mu'awwidha, for a chapter or a surah which is used as a mean of protection. Okay, Barakallahu Fiki. There remain for you one question, inshallah, I'll answer after this phone call. Assalamu alaikum. Sister Amina, assalamu alaikum, welcome to Ask Huda.
Please, Sheikh, I'm new here in Cairo. I'm asking whether there is any Islamic schools where I can put my children for Islamic studies. So I don't know whether if you can advise me on some Islamic schools. I'm living in Rehab. I don't know whether there is Islamic schools around this area. Thank you very much.
Which part of Cairo are you living in?
I'm living in Rehab.
Rehab. There is plenty of Islamic private schools, but of course it costs a lot if you're willing or if you can afford it. Otherwise, many foreigners, I mean with the word foreigners, expat, because every Muslim is not a foreigner to other Muslims. Okay, so when you come to Egypt, when you go to Saudi, when you go to Sudan, it's one ummah. I mean with the word foreigner from out of the country. They come here and they bring their children to Islamic schools or offices of Tahfidh al-Quran and teach in Arabic, or they invite a private tutor. You can do it either way. It depends what ages and what grades are your children in and whether you can afford to send them to private schools, to Al-Azhar schools or private institutes or not. Okay? But there is plenty of schools nearby Rehab, not in Rehab itself, but nearby, like in Nasser City, in New Cairo, right? There is, I don't want to name any, this is not a commercial program, but there is definitely plenty of alternatives. Brother Muhammad from Kenya. Muhammad, assalamu alaikum.
Alaikum assalam. How are you, sir?
I'm fine. Please do me a favor and mute your TV set, Muhammad.
Okay, Sheikh, I would like a question.
Yeah. This is a question for you and for your baby, mashallah.
Yeah, and I like to. I love my religion, and I easily afraid to fall in a sin.
Okay.
What can you advise me or the other people like me, Sheikh?
Okay, Muhammad, wait a minute. You said you love your religion. What is the question then?
The question is, I am afraid to fall into a sin, easily fall into a sin.
Into a sin. Any sin? Okay.
Anything maybe.
Any sin. MashaAllah, la quwwata illa billah. You want to be a prophet then? Because only Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was infallible. All of us are inclined into sins by nature. كُلُّ بَنِي آدَمَ خَطَّاءٌ. This is what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said. All the children of Adam are committing sins. We incline by nature. This is a human nature. But he said, وَخَيْرُ الْخَطَّائِينَ التَّوَّابُونَ. And the best of those who commit sins are those who frequently repent. They hardly repent from those sins which they committed. But, you know, being very keen and being afraid to commit sins is a very good indication. Yani, I'd like to begin next episode, inshallah, by shedding some light on that. But sister Asia, as far as the children who left the house and the mother feels lonely, it's a shame on the children. It is very unfortunate. For the children, they should be dutiful to their parents. If it is required to take their parents, or if it is only one of the parents, the mother or the father, they shouldn't, especially if the parent is willing to move with them. If the parent is willing to move with them, because they are your responsibility. You cannot say, my wife doesn't want to, or my children, or whatever. It is your responsibility. It is a part of your duty to your parents. We have to look after our parents because the Prophet ﷺ said, this is your key to paradise. The Prophet ﷺ said in a very serious hadith, when he said Ameen and the Sahaba asked him, what did he say Ameen for? He said, Jibreel ﷺ came to me and said, woe to him or may he be disgraced, one who witnesses or attains the life of his parents or one of them at an old age and he does not get to enter paradise through serving them. This is an opportunity. Brothers and sisters, we definitely ran out of time, but inshallah Azza Jal will make it up next time if we live. Till then, أَقُولُ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَأَسْتَغْفُرُ اللَّهِ لِي وَلَكُمْ وَصَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَى نَبِيِّنَا مُحَمَّدٍ وَعَلَى آلِهِ وَصَحْبِهِ وَسَلَّمْ and see you next time. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Allah's my heart's speech, your mercy is what I beseech. Keep in my heart your remembrance, and in your deen allow me to advance. Help me in my quest, permit me to pass the ultimate test. Help me in my quest.